Jay Shrek, Myths, Legends, and Lies. And I'm here with
James.
James, today is the day that we stand up and say that I think the Lost Dutchman is going to be found this year.
I think that's true. I think this is the day that we can say that, given the fire, all the circumstances up in the soups that are currently happening.
You know, that if there was ever a time that there were and I put out a video that said the five reasons you won't find the Lost Dutchman. And a lot of that was based on the logistics of somebody who doesn't live here. Mm-hmm. So the first thing is, if you live here, you're going to have a better opportunity to be able to go out there, right?
That's true.
But, you know, as devastating as the fire was, and we all hate that. I mean, I hate the fact that that there was a fire. But the reality of it is, if there ever was a time somebody's going to find the Lost Dutchman, it's going to be this year. It's going to be 19 or 20, right?
Oh, I think so. I mean, yeah. I think there's so much more exposed, and we've eliminated two of the major why you won't find, you know, the Lost Dutchman reasons. And I think if enough dedicated people are out there, it's going to turn up.
I'm going to go out on a ledge or a limb, whatever you want to call it, and I'm going to tell you where I think the Lost Dutchman is. Okay. I'm actually going to go out on a limb and tell people where I think the Lost Dutchman is. Not going to do it just yet, but I'm going to tell you in this series, in this podcast, I'm going to tell you where I think the Lost Dutchman is.
Okay.
I'm going to tell you where we're going to throw all our chips. Because eventually what you have to do is decide, okay, you can go all the way around Superstition, right? Where is it? Where do you think it is? You know, that's what it's going to come down to. Where are you going to invest your energy, time, and energy? And I believe that after some of the discussions we've had, that I'm going to be all in on one location. Doesn't mean it's there, but I'm going to look at the history, and I already know in my head where that is. So what's going to be the most difficult thing for the average person coming in from somewhere else? What's the journey? What's the problems they're going to deal with? What are they going to deal with out there, James?
Well, first you got to narrow in what you're going to search, because we're talking 166,000 acres of land. Second, it's dealing with the elements, the conditions, getting out there, you know. And from that point, it's how are you going to start searching? You know, because mm-hmm. I mean, you gotta pinpoint all those things before you kind of, you know, Adolf Ruth it and just wander around the wilderness of the Superstition Mountains, because you know it's not a friendly, welcoming place necessarily.
Do you believe? How much do you believe that people like Tex try to divert people from originally where he thought the Lost Dutchman was?
Oh, based on my research, I think all those guys spent a lot of their energies diverting people from whether it's ranching land, their private land, or where they think the gold is. It seems like a lot of energy was invested in getting people to not go where they wanted them to.
You know, the biggest thing that I see, the biggest hurdle for the most people that are coming out here is the time, right? The time that they have to spend. Mm-hmm. One thing that I have never done is I have not hiked in forest fire afterwards, you know? I don't know what I'm going to deal with that. I've never done that. I've walked in some places. I've hiked through places that would burn a couple of years, but yeah. Not fresh where, you know, it's got to be a mess.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, and that's a whole other thing to think about, because, you know, it takes a while for them to even clear it for people to go through, because roots and stuff like that still have the potential to have embers in them. So it takes forever for them to even clear those areas, from what I understand. I've only been in post-burn, like you said, like a year after at the soonest. So it'll be a whole other, you know, project kind of determining where you can go, what's safe. And what you're going to be getting into, because, you know, with all that brush and stuff, I don't know if more animals come back, like snakes and reptiles, or if there's going to be less of that stuff. And that's all going to create a whole new, you know, project as far as getting out there and looking for this gold.
How much different do you think that the land is today, you know, pre-burn, in the way it was 100 years ago?
I think there's... I mean, it'd be hard to say. I've looked at some pictures and stuff, but I know, like, Fish Creek, for instance, got kind of overgrown and all that underbrush. Like, when we were down Rogers Canyon, because of the winters we've had post-drought, it was just insane. The trail was just trashed. Like, half of the trail we were walking around, you know, down to trees and stuff, and I don't imagine that maybe being the case 100 years ago.
How many full-time Dutch hunters do you think are out there, honestly? I mean, we see a couple here and there. We see YouTube videos. Yeah. We see a few here and there. But, I mean, how many do you really think are doing this full-time?
I wouldn't really know. Because, I mean, at the time I'm up in there, like, I don't run into a lot of guys doing it, you know? I don't see it on our... I mean, it's a huge area. But I would say there's definitely a handful of, like, true Dutch hunters out there for sure.
You know, 10 years ago when I was out there, I saw more people than I do today. I don't see anybody. I mean, I've seen very few people that I consider to be serious Dutch hunters mm-hmm. versus serious hikers that are really serious about it. You know, one time, I would say there was probably, in any one time, 10 serious Dutch hunters over the last 15 to 30 years that were out there. And you just don't see them anymore. Like, you know, I don't see them like that. I think there'll be a record amount this year. I think that I'm going to go out on a limb and say that it's going to be a record amount of people die out there this year.
That's
like, because I think the influx of people coming in are going to be triple. I mean, if you ever dreamed of getting this treasure and your buddies, this would be the year to go try and do it, right? I mean, would you agree?
It would seem that way for sure. I would definitely agree with you on that. Cause I mean, you know, I feel like a lot of people are on the same page. I've seen a couple other people posting some stuff regarding, you know, this being the time because of the fire. So we'll see.
I think we first kind of reported that. I've seen some other channels that are exactly. into the Dutch. A lot of it more is history of the superstition, which is great. But that's just, you know, I only look at the history to be able to say, okay, where's that going to lead us to wherever it might mm-hmm. be? I also predict that if it was ever going to be found, it's going to be found this year, just like I said earlier. I think the biggest hurdle of the Lost Dutchman, finding the Lost Dutchman, the biggest hurdle was the harsh landscape.
Oh, absolutely. And just, you know, years and years of growth, years and years of, you know, rock slides, all the elements out there make it that much more difficult and easier for it to have been covered up. You know, mm-hmm. Displaced from its original, you know, setting right. or whatever. Right. So, I mean, all right. those things, I think, played huge factors right. that have been changed dramatically.
So, if I'm coming in here, and I always use Ohio. I don't know why I use Ohio, but I like Ohio. So, if I'm coming in here out of Ohio, and I want to go search for the Lost Dutchman, What tip would you give what would be the first tip that you would give anybody coming in here from out of state?
Get used to the conditions out here. Get used to the fact that even in fall, the afternoon temperature is not what you're going to be used to out there. It's mm-hmm. going to be hot and you're not going to have lots of shade. Your water will get warm. So, you know, all of those are really playing against you if your body's not used to that, you know.
Yeah. The number one tip. Conditioning. And you know what's funny is the worst video that we've ever put out was when I did a conditioning video and nobody in this day and age want yeah. your physicality yeah. to be one of the most important things to finding treasure, right?
Yeah, but if you research the history, I mean, that's really what's the first thing that gets in a lot of people's way, it seems. Whether it's just not being an avid hiker. I mean, and you're out in rough terrain. The marked trails are not easy trails out there. Like, you know, I would suggest if you're really coming out here, like, do the siphon draw trail just to see if you can hack it in those conditions before you even start trying to trek out into the wilderness area by yourself.
And you're probably right, but the siphon draw would kick most people's asses.
No,
Camelback would kick most people's mm-hmm. asses. And they don't realize it's an in-town hike that will whip exactly. your ass, right? I mean, yeah. as many people get pulled off that mountain as any.
Exactly.
And people automatically think it's in town, so it can't be bad, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, and, but you're not going to get, one thing you're not going to get is you're not going to get lost on Camelback. You get lost out in superstitions, and you can get lost out there pretty easy. So number one thing that you need to do is be in somewhat a condition, and that could be, hey, if you got to hike around the mall, mm-hmm. get used to being out, because everywhere that you're going to go is going to be a distance.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, once you pull off the road, like the 88, you're on walking trails. You know, there's no riding a vehicle in most places once you get, you know, to the trailheads that are, you know, Peralta, First Water, all that, which are, you know, the go-to spots to start looking for this. You're walking, you know.
And your phone's not going to work.
No, I've noticed once you get in a little ways, your service drops pretty mm-hmm. quick. And, you know, I would definitely, like, you know, invest in some GPS. But I'd also learn how to use maps, and I'd learn how to use my compass, because at this point, you know, you're navigating yourself through all that.
And that's not even going to matter at all if you physically can't get in there, it doesn't matter. Exactly. You're also probably, you're going to be hauling a pack. So mm-hmm. that contriply, now you've went times mm-hmm. 5 or 10, mm-hmm. right, versus no pack, right? Mm-hmm. Unless you're going to do quick day trips, which you're not going to get any real searching done on a day trip.
No, absolutely.
You know, you can have fun and it can be cool, and there's nothing wrong with that either, but you're not going to get anything done when really seriously looking for the Lost Dutchman.
No, if your true goal is to find that, like, you're planning on a week out there, you know, camping. So that's when you got to look into permitting and everything else too, because, like, the logistics of just getting out there in partial park, part wilderness, like, you know, what are you allowed and not allowed to do? Because I guarantee you're not going to be allowed to have a fire out there. Yeah. For a long time.
The conditioning first, okay? Mm-hmm. And then the preparation, the pre-conditioning, what you can be doing is, where am I going to go? Yep. How am I going to get there? Which story am I going to believe? Which direction? How am I going to dissect this down? And, you know, I want to say, I've never seen any videos like the one we're doing. Of all the videos I've seen, never seen anybody actually sit down and talk about what you got to do if you really want to go past that thought process and actually going out, at least even giving it an attempt. However serious or not serious, you know, there is an underground group of Dutch hunters that are out there that mm-hmm. are serious about this, that aren't doing what we do, that are really, I think part of the adventure is sharing it though.
Well, I was just going to say, I think that's why we come at it from a slightly different angle, because we're just as much interested in the history. So, like, it'd just be fun to find out whether or not it is out there, you know, right, what I mean? Right. So, and a lot of the guys are very secretive,
right,
that I follow and that I've seen, and we don't seem to be that way. We're not as concerned with us being the only ones who find it as we are, like, is it out there?
I mean, the big deal with me is that I just want somebody to find it. I just want it to be real, right?
Exactly.
Right.
Like,
So, first, get in shape. Mm-hmm. Second, prepare. Do your research, mm-hmm. right? We've talked about this. This is not new stuff either, right? This is any type of treasure, right? I don't care if you're looking for Forrest Fenn. I don't care if you're looking for whatever you are looking for. You need to be prepared.
Yeah, absolutely.
And because you're not going to, you know, some treasures you could ATV in, or even motorcycle in, or, you know, enduro type bikes, or ATVs, UTVs. Mm-hmm. I got an ATV at the ranch, and I can haul everything in there. I've got a UTV at the ranch. I can haul all that stuff, all the equipment, all the water, all the things that logistically I have to carry in, mm-hmm. that I have to carry in now. And, you know, I'm sure we haven't looked into it. Maybe we ought to. Is looking at taking a pack in. But, you know, most guys, gals, you know, that's going away too. There's still a few people out there that understand the Superstition Mountains, but not that many anymore.
No, yeah. It's kind of a dying interest as far as the business that, you know, existed during the, you know, early 20s, 30s, and 40s, when there was all the, you know, the old school Dutch hunters going out there. And,
you know, what's nice about this, or cool, really cool to me about the Dutch hunters, is that there's still a demand for people to watch these videos. I mean, it's not, I wouldn't want to have to depend on the whole channel to do nothing but Lost Dutchman stuff. Because there's a point where, you know, unless you're just out there in it all the time, because I like a lot of different stuff. I like the history. I like the ghost stuff. I like all that kind of mm-hmm. stuff. All the intrigue of all this whole mm-hmm. mysteries and treasure. And you know, just to say that you are a Dutch hunter is a pretty cool thing in my book.
No, absolutely.
To say that you went out and searched it. But the most important thing is that you can take that history back to wherever you're from, whether that's Mesa or Columbus, Ohio, right? Because you're alive. And that's the most important thing. If you don't get anything else we're talking about. And we're people that... I'm serious about the outdoors.
Yeah.
I know you are too.
Absolutely.
We trained yesterday, 110 degrees. Mm-hmm. I was out in it. You were out in it probably longer. But we were both out in it yesterday at 110 degrees. That's what you got to do. Because... So what's the so I get ready, one, I do my research, two, right?
Mm-hmm.
I plan to come out here, right? And I got to know where I'm going because you got 166,000 acres mm-hmm. that you're going to decide that, okay, so now what's the plan? Where am I going to go? Well, I'm going to tell you where we're going to go, where we're going to give it a shot a little later in the video. I'm going to tell you where we're going. And if you can go out there and find it and beat us to the punch, I'm actually okay with that as long as somebody finds it, mm-hmm. you know? And again, I don't know if we're right. I don't know if the direction we're heading is correct. I have no idea. But we're going to give this a whirl, and we'll videotape the whole journey, and I hope somebody beats me to the punch. I really do. I don't have an issue with that at all. I want somebody to find this treasure. Yeah, do I want to be us? Absolutely. So, you prepare. So, you do your research. You physically are ready to go. You've got a plan coming out here, how you're going to get out there and how you're going to do it. And then once you get out there, I'd say number four is that I'm going to grid wherever we're going to go. We're going to take a section that's going to be a mile, 2 miles, whatever you decide it to be, depending on the amount of time that you have out here. And then you're going to grid it back and forth.
Yeah, you got to narrow the spot now. Yeah. Because, you know,
Now, what I'm hoping is where before, depending on where it's at, the location that we are going to is so thick in brush that what I would have said that would have taken us a half mile square would have taken us a week. I'm expecting to be able to do it five times that amount because there's not going to be the brush there. We'll be able to see in and go, there's nothing there, which we could never do before.
Yeah. It was stuff that you literally could not get through without, cutting down trees and stuff. So
another part of this video could be the five reasons that you're not going to find it. And what is that? What's funny is you say it's the opposite, right? Mm-hmm. That you're not physically ready, okay? That you don't live here logistically, mm-hmm. right? And that you haven't done your preparation. Mm-hmm. And then you don't know where you're going when you get out there. And you're just not ready to do this.
Yeah.
So, if you are going to do it, all the great Dutch hunters probably are dead. You know, that were totally committed. Right?
For the most part, I believe. So,
But we physically, and the weather. Let's talk about the weather. The weather and the superstition, and I think that's a lot of why the Spaniards called it, the superstition.
Oh, yeah.
Because the weather changes. I remember that day we were out there, no weather, no rain in the forecast, sunny skies, and all of a sudden it's raining on us. And we're like, what the hell is this, right?
Yeah. And what you can watch those ominous storms passing, through the mountains, the four peaks and stuff that we were watching. And then all of a sudden it's right on you because the wind shifts. And
it's crazy.
And you would have not guessed that day. No one forecasted it. We checked. And we were
always check your weather.
Yeah.
If you're going to be in superstitions, you better check your weather. You had better check your weather.
Mm-hmm.
I'll get into the one of the most dangerous things I think is coming on in the superstition. And if you watch some of our other videos, you'll know what that is. But before I get into that, let's talk about the weather a little bit.
Oh, yeah.
It snows in the superstition.
It does.
People don't get that shit. They're like, well, wait a minute. It's right desert. In Phoenix, right?
No.
It snowed in the superstition. There's pictures on the internet if you haven't seen it. That's this extreme weather conditions you get in that place is absolutely insane.
No, and it is cold at night, even on warm days. Like, it's far enough away from the city that it is cold at night. So if you're planning for a really hot day and you're sweaty, and then you settle down for camp and your clothes are full of sweat, like, you're still at risk of hypothermia, which is something no one really And that's what so many people in the desert get themselves in trouble hiking with, is just the moderating your own body temperature. Mm-hmm. And you know, if you're not expecting that and you didn't prepare for it for the day, you can find yourself in some trouble really quick.
So you come in here in the summer and you get heat stroke, and you come in here in winter and you freeze to death.
Yep.
Now tell me that's not extremes for somebody that's not used to this kind of weather.
That's true.
You know, you get, I mean, you're sweating like a pig. Okay, I don't know any other way to put it, right?
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden you freeze at night.
Mm-hmm.
And there's just not too many places you can go in the world and be at these extremities, right, for the weather.
No, that's one of the things I love about Arizona, is like it's so different from so many places you can go. And if you're used to it or you are prepared for that, it's no really big issue. But if you're not, you find yourself in trouble, and we watch you get hauled off by a helicopter on the news tomorrow morning.
One of them spinning rides, too.
Yeah, you might.
Well, you not only get on it, but you have to go. Your $40,000 to $50,000 ride is like 100 miles an hour spinning.
You might be one of those two people a year that it happens to, or whatever they say. So, I mean.
Yeah, if I'm going to spend that kind of money, I don't think I want a Disney ride to go along with it. But, you know, the best way to keep from that is, guess what? Not get your ass in that
kind of
situation.
Don't be that guy.
Don't be that guy. So, you get extreme conditions in weather. Okay. Now, another thing that just sprouted up out of, man, there are some kooks that are going out to Superstition. Mm-hmm. Maybe there's always been kooks. Maybe they were different kooks. They were, I think the original kooks were the kooks that were just Lost Dutch hunters like us.
Like Crazy Jakes.
Yeah, they
were
Crazy Jakes and Lost Dutch guys, Dutchmen, right? Dutch hunters that, you know, and they were thinking you were going to get their treasure, and they would shoot you and kill you for it.
Yes.
Okay, so that's what you used to deal with. Well, first, originally, when you went out there, Indians were going to get your ass, right?
Yeah, the Apache.
The Apache Geronimo was going to get your ass, right? He was from there, right?
Yeah.
Then it was crazy cowboys, crazy miners.
No.
Now we've been finding devil worshiping shit out there, and it's like, what the hell is this? And I still don't know, but it's not the most comfortable people, I'm going to tell you, that I want to be around. And you know, one thing you're not supposed to do in the Superstition Mountains is carry firearms, wink wink. But you know, I've run into some weirdos in the Superstition Mountains, man. Weirdos.
Well, if you're not from here, you know, you might want to look up Apache Junction before you decide to go out by yourself into the Superstitions, and just look at, you know, some of the stuff that happens in Apache Junction, because, you know, its proximity to a certain type of population of maybe drug addicts and such also.
Yeah, so be careful.
Also brings itself to being, you know.
There have been a bunch of, that was weird. Well, we've seen all that.
Oh, yeah, man. Yeah.
And all the people getting buried out there. And I mean, there's a lot of weird stuff going on. And I don't know if it's the vibe of the place. I don't know if it's the energy of the place. I don't know what it is. But don't be surprised to not get into some weird, weird stuff. It's a weird area. It's a beautiful area, but it's a weird area. And everything's weird.
Yeah, you know? It's hard to explain, because it's, you get there and just weird stuff happens. You run into weird stuff. You can be in the middle of nowhere and all of a sudden run into people. Sometimes awesome, nice hikers, people interested in your interests, and sometimes you're instantly nervous.
So so you never know what you're going to run into out there. You never know what weather you're going to get. You don't know who you're going to run into. My two favorite stories is I was doing some tracking, and if you've seen some of those videos, you've probably heard the story. So I apologize if you have, but I ran into this guy in the middle of, it looked like he was 1890 miner, okay? Beard, it covered all the whole, it was, and big, he was a big guy too. It wasn't like he wasn't like out there hiking. He was out there more than just, he wasn't hiking in and out. I'll just put it that way. I don't know where he was living, but he wasn't hiking in and out. I could tell by how big he was, right? Mm-hmm. He was not hiking in and out. And he looked at me, and I looked at him, and I went, man, am I on an episode of the Twilight Zone? You know? Did I just wake up some badass dream? And then I ran into, and then I was probably 15 miles out. It was probably 108 degrees. And this young gal runs by me in a jogging suit.
Oh, trail runners. Yeah.
And I'm like, what the hell? How in the hell, you know, with one little ball of water, hello, hey. And I was like, holy shit. Made me feel bad about the fact of my physicality at that point. Okay. So, let's just say that you've done your research. Let's say you physically prepared. Where are you going to choose to find the Lost Dutchman? Okay. And here's what I've decided to do. Okay. I'm going to go off Adolph Ruth. Okay.
Okay.
Do I completely believe it? No. But the guy wrote in his diary, and the amount of brush that's out there in that area was ridiculous, right?
Right.
I'm going to take for granted that and follow the Adolph Ruth map and the Adolph Ruth story.
The Peralta Ruth map?
Yes. Mm-hmm. And that's where I'm going. And I guess that means you're going with
me. I think I'm there too then.
Okay. That's where we're headed, because that's the place that, you know what, of all the things and all the research, and I don't know if I totally believe it, but that's part of what you have to do too, is you just got to make a choice of, okay, here's where we're going, right?
Yeah.
And here's what we're going to do.
Yeah.
And so we're going to go into that area, we're going to take that, and we're going to take the opportunity and the chance, right?
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to go in there. That's not all. There's one other place I'm going to go. I'll leave that for a separate video, but it's also a separate treasure. But first, we're going in there. We're going to go see if we can't find that. We're going to go see if we can't get in there. And at that point, the guy says, okay, of all the things I believe or don't believe about Adolph Ruth is that why would he put in there that he found the treasure if he didn't? He's not writing to anybody. Now, the only thing is, somebody could have said, they could have added that in there to kind of throw somebody off.
You could speculate that, but I mean, you're not going to know unless you go out there and check it out. I mean, you really got to start checking these places off.
And so,
by physically being there.
You know, they went to try to find that after they found that map, right? Mm-hmm. But, you know, there's just so, I know there's so many holes out there. You know, I know there's so many places where you just can't see it. Because, you know, it's just like when you look at mines even here on South Mountain, and you can't see them until a certain time of the day, right? Where all of a sudden the tailings pop out because the light reflects differently, things like that.
The sun changes throughout the... Yeah, exactly.
I mean, if he saw it at 11 and they were there at 4, you
could have looked right over it.
You could get a totally different light. Yeah, well, with no brush... You should be able to see it at any time of the day.
Yeah, that really should play to your advantage, I would agree.
So that's what I believe.
Yeah.
And that's where I think that the start that we're going to start at, as soon as we can get in there, is take a look at where Ruth, the Peralta map, said that the gold was. And so we're going to go in and see if we can't find it. And...
I think it's worth it. Like I said, unless the lucky firefighter that we may or may not hear about, that's the only thing working against your Dutch hunters right now is that these guys have been in the middle of it. And honestly, if one of those guys found it, I'm so happy for them because I think they deserve it more than anyone at this point.
Well, you know, the video is the five reasons that you will or won't find the map or find the Lost Dutchman. And it's the same things. You either did get ready... physically, right?
Oh, yeah.
You either did prepare, you got yourself logistically adjusted, you had a plan to go in, and you had the time to go in.
Yep.
Or you didn't on all those different things.
Yeah,
right?
And I think you got to have a check on each of those to even have a chance at it.
Right.
And that's the deal. It's like we know, and history shows, tons of people who did all of those things and still haven't found it. And then we have the other side of that, which is tons of people who didn't do at least one of those things. And we read stories of their obituaries. You know, they don't make it out.
One thing that most people do have is a total disadvantage is not knowing the landscape and what they're really dealing with.
Yes.
You agree? Because 100%. You don't really know what you're getting into if you haven't dealt with the complexity of the weather, the complexity of the terrain, the complexity of, you know, and that, you know... If you did take a hike, it would be a good feeler if you really were got out there. You know, there should be a rule that you've got to go up Flatiron.
Yeah, that's like the, you know,
I mean, that would be rites of passage. That would absolutely rites of passage, right?
Yeah, exactly.
You know,
that, absolutely.
So that would be, yeah. You know, that'd be if you wanted to see another one would be is, hell, go camelback.
Yeah.
If you can't do camelback, don't go out the Superstition Mountains. Because camelback's a joke compared to, but it ain't a joke if you're not used to hiking. Yeah. Okay, go up those basic trails. Go to South Mountain. Go hike for a day in South Mountain where you're not going to get lost before you go get your ass in a lot of trouble out in the Superstition Mountains. Because people still die in South Mountain.
No, I mean that's the thing is like if you can be an avid hiker. From even up north Arizona, let alone, you know, the Pacific Northwest or East Coast. But those terrains are just completely different and unique to what the Superstitions is, which is like part forest, part desert, part high desert, everything in between, you know, flash floods. All these things are elements that are going to work against you out there. That,
you know... I was coming down the hill yesterday and almost busted my ass. Did bust my ass one place right here. Okay, so... And the point of this, what I'm saying to you is this. This terrain is so harsh. I brought a brand new pair of hiking shoes. Merrell Chameleons. I've had a ton of pairs, right? And I wore those shoes out in about 2 months now. And I guess I'm not knocking. I'm going to try a different brand, but it's not more of a slam on Merrell as it is that how harsh the environment is out here on everything. I mean, when you smoke a pair of Chameleons, which aren't cheap shoes, and they're heavy duty. Those are heavy duty shoes, and because I've had probably 20 pairs of them, But I went through them in a month and a half, two months.
One thing I've discovered is the Vibram material that they use on the soles of a lot of like hiking shoes and trail runners just doesn't hold up in the heat and the weird rocky conditions we have out here. So that's one of the things is like you almost have to all your gear almost has to be specific to, you know, being out in this desert climate. And I'm still experimenting with my favorite pair of, you know, trail runners and hiking boots and all sorts of stuff like that. You know, you want to look at like the type of socks you're wearing because, like, you know, you blister differently out here in these conditions than you do in other parts of the country.
Most people don't want to hear all this shit. They just want to go buy some gold.
No, it's just, yeah.
And I'm with them. I mean, you know.
It gets a little more boring, I'm sure. I apologize for that.
Well, I mean, my shoes, I can't hardly wear them. They're like ice, man, coming down the mountain. You know, like I said, I busted my ass the other day. And it's like, okay, because you don't want to go out and buy another $130 pair of shoes.
Exactly.
And when you need four pairs anyway, and you don't want to spend $500 on shoes. And that's another thing is financially, it's ridiculous the amount of money that you invest in going out and doing this kind of stuff.
Yeah, so. I mean, if I didn't have my background of the long distance backpacking and stuff, like, you know, I'd be screwed on this whole project that I joined in with you on. But just, you know, those are the little things that people don't think about a lot. So, you know.
Well, my prediction is The Lost Dutchman will be found in 19 or 20. Okay? Mm-hmm. That's my prediction. I'm not going to predict it's going to be me and you're just going to find it. But I predict if it's out there, it's going to be found this year.
If it's out there, hasn't already been found before, this is the time someone's going to stumble upon it.
Cool.
In my opinion.
Jay Shrek.
James.
On the trail of the Lost Dutchman.